Good afternoon.
Hello.
Welcome to the second annual Samuel Bowles Lecture of the UMass Amherst Economics Department. I'm Michael Ash, outgoing chair of the department. In addition to the department, the Samuel Bowles Lecture is made possible in part by a generous anonymous donation. I would also please thank Department Administrator Sheila Gilroy for her exceptional work in organizing the event, and the Political Economy Research Institute, and equally outgoing Administrator Judy Fogg for hosting the event. A reception in the Gordon Hall atrium will immediately follow the lecture. The purpose of the Samuel Bowles Lecture is to highlight outstanding work in the tradition of Sam Bowles. Last year, I was able to skimp on the introductory remarks because the lecturer and the lecturer conveniently have the same name. This year, I have to cover both. The story of Sam Bowles and the establishment of radical political economy at the University of Massachusetts is recounted in At the Edge of Camelot, Donald Kapsner's Intellectual History of Our Department, published by Oxford University Press, which tells the story of the early years of the modern economics department, beginning in 1973 through the early 1980s. So I will summarize briefly. Radicalized by the civil rights movement and the war in Vietnam, Sam Bowles was denied a tenure in a bitter political purge by the increasingly conservative Harvard University economics department, despite, or perhaps more accurately, because of his profound ideas and prolific record of publication. Sam made an exodus to Western Massachusetts and attracted an extraordinary cohort to UMass economics, including our late friend and colleague Stephen Resnick, and professors emeriti Herb Gintis, Richard Wolf, Rick Edwards, and Jim Crotty. Soon thereafter, the Valley filled with exceptional students who would make up the next generation of political economists. One of those first students is today's speaker, Manuel Pastor, Jr. Manuel is a Californian raised in Los Angeles. He earned his bachelor's degree at the University of California, Santa Cruz. Attracted, undoubtedly, by our fine weather and by the unique opportunity presented by the fledgling UMass Amherst Department of Economics, Manuel came east to UMass for graduate school and studied with Sam Bowles, among others. After Manuel completed his PhD in economics here in 1984, he joined the faculty of Occidental College, soon becoming associate and later full professor of economics. Manuel then returned for 10 years, now as professor, to the University of California, Santa Cruz, where he created and directed the Center for Justice, Tolerance, and Community. That's when I first met him. But the call of Los Angeles was strong, and Manuel returned to the city, taking his current post as professor of sociology and American studies and ethnicity at the University of Southern California. At USC, Manuel created and continues to direct the Program for Environmental and Regional Equity and the Center for the Study of Immigrant Integration. Manuel's honors are legion. He is an inaugural holder of the Terpanchian Chair in Civil Society and Social Change at the University of Southern California. He has received many national awards for research, teaching, and outreach and engagement. Guggenheim, MacArthur, Kellogg, Ford, Rockefeller, Carnegie, Haas, Hewlett, Irvine, Gates, Annenberg, and Russell Sage are among the many foundations that have recognized Manuel's work with awards and with large research grants. Manuel is the author of some 17 books and monographs, many, many peer-reviewed articles and chapters, and countless reports from climate change to banking justice to public health. Manuel's reports do not sit neatly on shelves gathering dust. Manuel's work stands out for his close ties to the social movements that can do something with his ideas and with him to address the economic, environmental, and social conditions facing low-income urban communities. I felt since I first met him that for Manuel, relevant research is really a call. Before I hand over the floor, I want to pay tribute to how much I have learned from Manuel. One of Manuel's many streams of research concerns environmental justice, analysis and advocacy about disparities in access to environmental goods and exposure to environmental bads. And his thinking and research have had profound effects on me. I've learned how forces of economic change make communities vulnerable to environmental degradation and how communities can resist. I've learned that community elders sometimes know political economy better than the econometricians do. I've learned that the world is round and has rhomboid-shaped implications for fine-scale measures of solution exposure. I've learned it's incredibly fun to visit Manuel at USC to geek out for a day or a week. I've learned that writing and rewriting to make complex findings accessible to broader communities is a deeply worthwhile pursuit, indeed a responsibility, and that community engagement is the most important pathway for meaningful research. Recently, Manuel has published two volumes of Cornell University Press, Unsettled Americans, Metropolitan Context and Civil Leadership for Immigrant Integration, and This Could Be the Start of Something Big, How Social Movements for Regional Equity Are Reshaping Metropolitan America. He also recently co-authored with Chris Benner, Equity, Growth, and Community, What the Nation Can Learn from America's Metro Areas. Based on that work and more recent developments, one of them raising the level of uncertainty, Manuel Pastor will now deliver the second annual Samuel Bowles Lecture, Equity, Growth, and Community, Progressive Economics, Metro Strategies, and Social Movements in Uncertain Times.
That was a very kind introduction. I'm a little tired, though, after listening to it. The one part that Michael didn't bring up that I think is really key is despite all that change and transformation over time, I'm married to the same woman. We like to say we've been married together now 35 years, many of them happily, so it's been good. And I would note for Michael, there's a sort of thin line between outgoing and out of here, which I think I'm hearing, so good luck to the incoming chair as we move forward. So I'm gonna talk a little bit from this book that we wrote about a year ago, we wrote it about 2 years ago, and it seems sort of remarkably prescient because we were trying to talk about how a sort of combination of demographic anxiety and economic uncertainty and epistemic distance between groups was creating a fundamental crisis in the United States. And my gosh, the election sure seems to have lived up to those expectations. So that's a little bit of what I'm gonna talk about. You might wanna let you know why I'm using a mic. For some of you, you might think it's because I'm trying to look like Lady Gaga at the Super Bowl. It's not, although it's that over the last 5 years, and Michael and a few other people know this, I've developed a speech disorder that's called spasmodic dysphonia, spasms around the voice box, which is something that Diane Rehm on NPR talked about quite a bit. Robert Kennedy Jr. has it too. Now me. So it can cause your voice to spasm a little bit or not project very well. And that's because it gets treated, actually, this is literally true, once a month with Botox. Yeah. Because,
so you're beautiful.
Because that's how, exactly. And that's how we treat everything in Los Angeles. It really works for us. I'm super glad to be back. So I'm going to talk about this talk, but I want to bookend it with two things. The first is what I learned from being at UMass, and the second that I'll end with is what I learned from Sam, who was one of my mentors while I was here. So here's what I learned at UMass. Aside from the fact that you've got horrible weather, and I wanted to be back in Los Angeles, by the way, when I first moved back to LA from being at UMass, I used to call some of my friends on the East Coast and say, I'm shoveling sun out of my driveway. What are you doing? I lost a lot of those friends, and so I decided to be kinder in my phone calls. But what I really learned here were sort of three things that stuck with me, and you'll see them come out today. One was something I think the UMass Econ program was sort of famous for, but it was a little bit submerged in the blaze of glory about being radical, which was that people construct markets, they're social institutions, and markets construct people. They form who we are. That whole notion of endogenous preferences, the whole notion of sort of structures and the way that they change who we are, you're gonna see coming up in here, because a lot of the talk I'm gonna be presenting has to do with the creation of epistemic communities, knowledge communities, and how they create social norms that are based in data and dialogue, and then allow people to find some consensus moving forward. So that was one real big takeaway. The second big takeaway, which you're gonna see here, harkens back to my dissertation. In my dissertation, which looked at the International Monetary Fund and its impacts on income distribution, description, bad. What I basically did in that was to take an IMF methodology and copy it, but wind up looking at income distribution so that when they sit, they couldn't say anything was wrong with my method, but instead have to grapple with the fact that the single biggest impact of the International Monetary Fund was on lowering labor's share of income. Echoes of that today, because what I'm going to talk about in part is an empirical strategy we borrowed from the IMF to show that equity actually, or inequality, actually slows economic growth in America's metropolitan areas. Hard to criticize, because it's an IMF method. The third thing I learned from UMass, and this is actually on the night that I defended my dissertation, we had a party at my house, and as we were leaving, and this will sound bad initially, but it's actually not, as Sam was leaving, I walked him out to his car, and he said, you know, you did really well today, but I can't tell whether you're smart or you just tell a good story. and I responded, and some of you might have been insulted by that, but I didn't take it though. I said, what's the difference? Because I think telling a good story, figuring out what the story is that your research is about, is incredibly important. So let me kind of set the stage for this book with these trends that actually have now really kind of come in full blossom with the election. And the first, of course, and this is one big strand in the election, is demographic change. You can see here that the United States is projected by the year 2043, 2044, to become so-called majority-minority, or as I like to think of it, all-minority all the time. And, you know, already the underage population is majority kids of color. That's going to sort of filter through going forward. And it's, of course, that economic anxiety or this demographic anxiety that has had a big impact on the identity crisis, really, of some folks who voted for Trump, who felt like America was slipping away on them demographically. For some of us, hearing the news that the U.S. will become majority people of color is a great thing. It means more Korean taco trucks, which, by the way, is a big thing in Los Angeles. It means more cultures coming together. But for others, it's a very frightening thing. Now, we've been through this before. If you look at the demographic change in the United States between 2000 and 2050, where the U.S. becomes majority people of color sometime before that, that's basically the demographic change that California went through between 1980 and 2000. And in some ways, and I'll get back to some of the other data points on this, the United States just had its Prop 187 moment. Prop 187 was the famous anti-immigrant proposition in California in 1994. It came after a gigantic recession in which 50% of the job losses in the United States had occurred in California. Industry was disappearing, and in particular, echoes of the United States as well. The sort of black deindustrialization had occurred a decade earlier. This was the white deindustrialization with aerospace shrinking. All of a sudden, it was a crisis, right? Crack cocaine had erupted, right? The opiates of that day. But when this transformation took place in 1994, big demographic changes, we got this anti-immigrant hysteria, and that kind of happened in California, which is now kind of come on the other side of it. When you think about the demographics of what was going on in California at the time, really what was going on in part was a rise in the share of foreign-born. Now, this is something that the rest of the country is now grappling with as well. But in the 80s and in the 90s, if you look at the share of foreign-born, this is California, and then the orange line is the rest of the United States, taking California out, which, by the way, is something we're actually really into right now, is separating ourselves from the rest of the United States, because we don't fucking understand you all. So, I know you're videotaping this, sorry. But you can see that the increase in the share of foreign-born that was going on, quote-unquote, in the United States, was in the 80s and 90s, actually mostly occurring in California. Huge increase in the share of foreign-born. It's now stabilizing in California. For the last 2 years, the share of foreign-born has been on the decline. The share of foreign-born in Los Angeles has been on the decline for the last 4 years. The increase in immigrant population is occurring in other parts of the country, and the anxiety that it triggered in California, it's being triggered in other parts of the country as well, as you can see from the data points here. So what's interesting, though, is that's really a sort of reshuffling of the immigrant population in some ways, because the immigration flow into the United States is stabilizing. Immigrants from Asia are now outpacing immigrants from Latin America. Many of you know this, net migration from Mexico is actually negative. There's more Mexicans returning to Mexico than coming to the United States, partly because of economic growth there, partly because of changed fertility rates in Mexico, so less of a push factor, which, by the way, means that, and I keep trying to tell people this, that if we build a wall, we're just penning Mexicans into the United States. It's probably not what Trump had in mind. So big demographic changes, and those changes now are being driven less by immigration and more by the growth rate in children. This shows you for 2000 to 2010, the number of young whites in the United States actually fell by 4.3 million. That does not mean that 4.3 million young white people died. We would have noticed that. It means more moving into 19 and 20 than moving into 1 and 2. You can see that the growth rate in the youth population, entirely Latino and Asian Pacific Islander, African American population, more or less stable, probably folks redesignating to some degree into the multiracial category. But what's driving this now nationwide is births. Interesting thing to take a look at too, and then we'll move from the demographics to a little bit of the economics and then to what this book was about, is about the demographic change where it's occurring. So this is the United States in 1980, and it looks like what a lot of people still think the U.S. looks like, the Black Belt of the South heading to D.C., the borderlands of Texas with Mexico, the Hispanic and Native American areas of Arizona and Nevada. You'll notice something about California. California had only one county, Imperial County, on the border with Mexico that actually was majority people of color. Los Angeles itself had not yet crossed that threshold. As you move from 1980 to 1990 to 2000 to 2010, you can see a lot of change, but a lot of change in California. Now, what's interesting is that what most people think then is that because so much change occurred in California, that's what's going to drive the change in the rest of the United States, that somehow by the year 2050, California will become 150% Latino, sort of super Latinos marching the earth, right? Declaring La Reconquista, Aslanique, we are back. But really what's going on is that the demographic change is going to occur in a lot of the rest of the United States, some exceptions, slowing down in California. Two interesting things to note about this. One place you wouldn't expect that's going to become majority people of color is Salt Lake City. I know, I thought the same thing as you. Salt Lake is not just white, but sort of shiny white, right? Sort of Book of Mormon white, right? But it's actually on a pretty rapid demographic change. You'll know what's interesting is that the Midwest and the areas that were the Trump voters are not going to experience this demographic change. So the most anxiety that's occurring is in places where the change is not really occurring. It's a sort of fear of the other and a sort of fear of loss. So big demographic change, and that big demographic change has been coupled with high levels of economic uncertainty. The data on this is familiar to a UMass Amherst crowd. Super sharp increase in the share of the income going to the top 1%. That's the blue line. This is Manuel Sice's data. Bigger increases going in the since the 70s and early 80s to those between the 1 and 5% of the income distribution, also to the 5 to the 10%, but a lot of action happening at the sort of top 1%. What's going on as well is something sort of beneath that, beneath that is what's going on for full-time year-round workers. And this just shows you, again, data that'll be fairly familiar to you. People who are at the 90th percentile for full-time year-round workers have seen increases in their real wages between 1980 and 2010. And as you move down, the distribution of full-time year-round workers decreases. And the orange bars are California, more of an accelerated pattern in California, just like America. California was sort of America fast forward demographically. It's been America fast forward in terms of the level of inequality. So the 1% running away from the rest, and then beneath this, these shifts in the labor market, which are discomforting, even if you're sort of in the 99%. That is that people who are highly skilled are making much more than they did in the past. People who are less skilled making less than they did in the past. The way I talk about this for popular audiences is I'm a professor. I make much more money than a professor ever did in the past because there's a premium for the kind of education and skills we've got. My dad was a janitor. If he was still alive, he'd be making a lot less money than a janitor ever made. But beneath that sort of distributional and labor market story is incredible anxiety about the future. Anxiety because work is becoming precarious, temporary, part-time, and changing. Anxiety because it requires a sort of other level of talent in terms of creativity. Interestingly, work is increasingly caring, not in the way we treat workers, but in the nature of work, because we've got much more care work that's taking place that's very poorly rewarded. But this anxiety about the changing workplace is also what's fed into the Trump victory. And you could have heard the rumblings of this before, of the white steel worker who may still actually even have a steel job, but feels like his children will never be there. But also in the young folks who voted for Bernie Sanders as a result of their anxiety about the future as well. My kids were enthusiastic Bernie supporters. My son in particular, he is 30 years old. He is a musician whose backup career is as an actor. So there's plenty to be anxious about. A couple of years ago, he's always had good girlfriends, but a couple of years ago he had a girlfriend, great, great young woman. He was 26, she was 23, and he told me one day, "Dad, she's from an entirely different generation." And I was like, how is that possible? And he said, well, you know, she came of age during the Great Recession. She expects she's never going to have a job for the rest of her life. So there's this tremendous anxiety for young folks with the college debt, with the sense of the labor market turning over, with the sense that if you're an Uber driver now helping to destroy the taxi cab industry, that job is not going to be for you in the next 5 or 10 years as they move to driverless cars. So tremendous anxiety. So demographic change, economic anxiety, and then one final factor that fed into the election, but these were things we were noticing before the election for this book that we wrote, which is growing social distance. And that growing social distance has taken a lot of different forms, and it's something I think economists ought to take a little bit more seriously. We talk about distributional changes, but we forget about epistemic changes, the ways in which people's lives become increasingly distant from one another, and people don't see themselves in the other, and therefore, how can you see any kind of politics of solidarity when there is so much social separation? That social separation has taken a couple of different forms. One thing is that in the United States, in fact, residential segregation between African Americans and whites has been on the decline in our major metro areas, slightly. Residential segregation between Latinos and whites has been on the increase slightly. But what's been on the increase is segregation by class. Increasingly, high-income people sorting into high-income neighborhoods and then able to tell themselves a story about how smart they all are together. And low-income folks being sorted into low-income neighborhoods with the problems of concentrated poverty that that brings. Growing social distance in our schools. This is data on what percent of kids in the United States by ethnic group live in or go to school in high poverty schools, which means schools where more than 75% of the population is on free or reduced lunch. Less than 10% of white kids go to those schools in the United States. About half of African-American kids and about half of Latino kids go to those schools. So tremendous social distance in the educational experience, in parents thinking about themselves and their own common ground. And then one thing that folks don't realize that sort of has accompanied this demographic change, and it's the age structure of our population. So this is the median age by race and ethnicity in the U.S. for the year 2014. The median age for non-Hispanic whites in the United States is 43 years. For API, Asian Pacific Islanders, 36. African Americans and Black Americans, 33. For Latinos, the median age is 28. So that's a big difference. That's 15 years. That's a generation gap. It's a racial generation gap. When an older group doesn't see itself in a younger group, and if you don't think that has consequences, two data points to keep in mind. One is, what state in the United States do you think has the biggest racial generation gap, the whitest old and the brownest young? Arizona, with its fractious politics around immigration, with its fights around ethnic studies in the schools, but more significantly, with its, it had the third largest cuts in the last 5 years in K through 12 spending per capita, and the largest cuts in university spending just as a new generation is arriving. Now, if you think that that's just something that's a casual the point I'm making, we've actually done a thing where we looked at county level local spending on education, controlling for multiple variables that predict education spending in a fixed effects regression, and the racial generation gap in your county has a statistically significant effect on reducing spending on education. So we've got a generational gap, and we've also got a big social gap in terms of our institutions and our knowledge formation. Our institutions are broken. This is a chart that I love. Kind of, we should do more charts like this. This is comparing Congress to various other things, which is more popular. So if you compare Congress to lice, Congress is, people prefer lice by 67%. If you prefer Congress to a colonoscopy, it's 58%. And I think that's primarily because there's people below 50 who have never had a colonoscopy, right? The only thing that Congress is almost as popular as is the band Nickelback, right? Which, of course, shows extraordinarily bad taste. But the other thing that's going on is a kind of epistemic distance, right? Living in places that are essentially very different reality universes. So it's become famous with alternative facts. It's become famous with Baghdad Bob, speaking from the pulpit there, Sean Spicer, increasingly distanced from reality. The way in which there's not a basic agreement on sort of what the facts are that people are talking about. So this combination of what we, in this book, wanted to address, this came out in late 2015, and we talked about the fact, interestingly, that we thought that the U.S. was facing a jobs crisis, and that jobs crisis was key because jobs provide people identity and meaning. That the U.S. was facing an inequality crisis, and that the U.S. was facing an epistemic crisis, that was partly about race, but it was actually facilitated by the other ways in which people were siloing and sorting and separating, and we wanted to write a book looking at these different aspects. How would we address our jobs crisis by facing our inequality crisis, and how is that connected to addressing the epistemic crisis? And then we wanted to say, how is this happening at a metro level, and how might it bubble up to the nation before we got a Trump? But apparently that didn't happen soon enough. So what we did in the book is to do a couple of different things. We wanted to, in this book, establish that equity, paying attention to inequality, was actually a fundamental building block for achieving prosperity and achieving job growth. That is, that the inequality and job crisis were actually connected. The second, a little bit more controversial, is that we wanted to make a very simple point that knowing together creates a possibility for growing together. That is, that if you can create knowledge communities in which people share facts and dialogue, there's a possibility of resolving tensions between groups in ways that don't happen in the usual atomistic and sort of sharply divided political struggles that take place. We had hinted at this in an earlier bit of research called Just Growth, but we wanted to try to specify it a little bit further here. And then also to complicate this, because that framework of knowing together creates the possibility of growing together can sound like a kumbaya framework, right? That if we all sit down and love one another, and if you're from California, get naked in a hot tub together, right? Celebrate your medical marijuana with your friends. That somehow that, you know, a good thing will come from it. But we wanted to point out that conflict was a way of forming community. That there was a way in which conflict and raising tough issues was actually a way of creating dialogue between sectors that could change minds. So that's a lot to try to do in one book, but it, I think, turns out to be a really good book. I urge you to buy it. If you don't want to buy it, it's actually available for free as a download from UC Press. It's a new model they're trying so that people actually read academic books. And then if you are particularly don't even want to read it, you can simply wait until the motion picture comes out, which is, of course, what happens because I'm in LA. I'm actually having to rush back tomorrow morning to finish negotiating the movie rights. I'm going to be portrayed by Antonio Banderas, and I'm super excited about that. So let me talk through the different pieces of this. It was a very mixed method project, and it's led to a couple of different things. So the first part of it was empirical. That part actually did a really interesting, from my point of view, transposition. I think many of us are aware that the old framework around inequality and economic growth sort of rooted in a misinterpretation of the Kuznets curve that Piketty points to as being very sort of historically rooted one, was that somehow inequality might be good for economic growth. And in some ways, Marxism has sometimes fallen into this as well by thinking that higher rate of exploitation is going to generate more investment and growth. It's kind of an early critique I made of some of the radical critiques at the International Monetary Fund. Instead of looking at their class impacts, they were looking more at growth impacts. But there's been this kind of extraordinary shift in economic thinking. It actually first started in the developing world context when people began to take a look at the fact that countries that had a more equitable starting point, better land distributions, more equitable distributions of education, more equitable distributions of income, actually tended to grow more over time. It was coupled by a bunch of research by people like Alessine and Roderick, taking a look at the fact that places plagued by high levels of inequality tended to get into a lot of macroeconomic instability because they couldn't come to the political consensus about how to adjust. About 10 years ago, I and a bunch of others began trying to lift that research and sort of place it into the American metropolitan context, trying to take a look at the relationship between measures of poverty, measures of residential segregation, et cetera, and looking at the impact of those things on economic growth, looking at things like the 80-20 income ratio, where it's bigger, there's more inequality, looking at the impacts of that on growth. In this book, and then the sort of articles that came from it, what we decided to do, some of you, if you were paying attention, saw something a bit startling from the International Monetary Fund from about 3 or 4 years ago, the set of studies by Berg and Ostry that were looking at what predicted growth spells. The idea was that if a country could sustain growth for a longer time, it created a more secure political environment, a more secure environment for investment. And they wanted to take a look at what predicted sort of growth spells over time. And they defined growth spells as being able to sustain GDP growth for longer than 5 years. They looked at 104 growth spells of more than 5 years for 140 countries since the 1950s. And for them, the striking result was that income inequality was the most robust predictor of whether or not you could sustain growth over time. And they found that a 1% increase in the initial Gini coefficient led to about an 11 to 15% reduction in the length of being able to sustain growth over time. So that sounded to me like an opportunity to do something like what I'd done in my dissertation, which is to yank some methodology from the IMF and, with my friend Chris Benner, apply it to the United States. So what did we do? What we wound up doing was to look at spells of employment growth. We said what predicts the ability to sustain job growth over time. So we pulled in job growth data from QCW, from those who are familiar with it. We looked at spells of employment growth from 1990 to 2011 for the top 184 metros in the United States. Those were all metros that had more than 250,000 people as of 2000, I think it was, in the middle of the time period. We defined a growth spell as being able to sustain 12 quarters of consecutive job growth year over year. We tried alternative measures. The results are not sensitive, but we tried alternative measures. And we wind up with those 184 metros having 324 periods of sustaining employment growth over time. And we used a kind of variation of what Berg and Ostry used. They used a technique that's called accelerated time ratio, but one that's sort of more familiar, probably not familiar because I don't think economists use either of these things mostly, is a survival analysis. So looking how long a phenomena survives. And what we're looking for in a survival analysis is whether or not you can predict how you exit from the spell. So you're growing, what throws you off having sustained growth over time. Now there's a couple of methodological concerns with this. One the two that concern people are if your data is time limited, you've got a right censoring phenomena because the spell could last longer, right? Fortunately for us, but unfortunately for the world, it was a great recession. And so almost everybody's employment spell, except one, stopped and then didn't reboot quick enough to be a 3-year spell in that period of time. The other thing you've got to worry about is left censoring if you had a growth spell before the time period that you've got. And for that, what we did was we took all the cases of left censoring, tossed them out. We used them, then we tossed them out to see whether the results were robust. They were robust. So unlike some of these techniques, we didn't really have to worry about censoring on either side. A couple things to motivate it, then the regressions. First, there really is a relationship. the higher the Gini coefficient, the shorter the growth spell, the lower the Gini coefficient, the longer the growth spells. By the way, there's another thing in here. Your growth spell can start in the 90s or can start in the 2000s. So when we do the work, we're looking at the initial coefficient either from 1990 for the 90 spells or from 2000 for the 2000 spells. Again, it's not too sensitive if you just go back to the 90 coefficients. So it looks like we've got a relationship there. If you look at the length of growth spells, how long any growth spell is, again, it looks like you've got a relationship. The higher the Gini coefficient, the shorter the growth spells. These are associated with growth rates. And then one final bit to convince you that this is actually important. Because one objection you could have is, well, you know, growing for a long time, but maybe it's like a real dud of a phenomena, right? You're growing really slowly, so, you know, big deal. So this is the, of the 184 metro areas, 181 of them had growth spells. In the book, we let you know which three metro areas had no growth spells at all, but it's kind of embarrassing to talk about them, right? So these are all 181 regions. And the number of quarters any of those regions spent in growth spells. So what you can see is that if you were a region, 36 of them spent a lot of time in growth spells, 18, 35, 21 to 20, 2012, spending 12 quarters in a growth spell, which means you only had one growth spell over the whole period, or less than 30, that's about 35. What you're going to notice is the more time a region spends in a growth spell, this is employment growth over the whole period. The more time it spends in a growth spell, the more employment growth over the whole period. The more time it spends in a growth spell, the bigger the increase in weekly earnings over the whole period. So looking at growth spells, it's associated with faster growth rates, the chart I kind of jumped over, but it's also just associated, the more you spend growing, the better off you are after 21 years. So what predicts being in a growth spell and not, or falling out of a growth spell? This is, fortunately, what I love about kind of mimicking IMF work is that they do really basic, stupid stuff, and then we can do basic, stupid exploratory stuff and say, hey, they did it. They explored a lot of relationships, and then they kind of put it all together in a parsimonious model. That's basically what we did too. What we found out, a couple of different things the darker colors are more significant, the lighter colors are less significant. But basically, the two variables, so it turns out the percent of population born that's foreign born is actually associated with you falling out of a growth spell. We haven't quite figured out why that is. Having a lot of people in manufacturing, that's associated with you falling out of a growth spell. Kind of makes sense given our manufacturing structure. But in this regression, and it's not sensitive to this particular specification, the two most important variables are the initial level of income inequality is likely to shorten your growth spells, and then something called metropolitan power diffusion. Metropolitan power diffusion is the fragmentation of government structures within your metropolitan area, which is also a sign of epistemic distance or Tibetan sorting, where people are trying to kind of be in separate governments so that they're not taxing themselves for the commons. So equity might be good for economic growth. Social distance is actually not good for being able to sustain growth over time. We also did a little bit of looking at the politics of it. I want to jump over the econometrics right now to talk about the field work and then sort of bring this to a conclusion. But the punchline of the econometrics was trying to create a platform for the idea that inequality and social distance, because some of the other variables like residential segregation was significant, city, suburb differentials in poverty rates were significant, that social distance would shorten your growth spell. So then we wanted to take a look at the question of which, how did communities close some of the epistemic distance? And I give one example, then jump through a few of the case studies and conclude. This is Jacksonville, Florida in the 1960s. In fact, on August 27th, 1960, when in the city of Jacksonville, lunchtime or lunch counter protesters were met with a crowd of 200 whites armed with baseball bats and axe handles who attacked them. On a Saturday, they became known in Jacksonville history as Axe Handle Saturday. The police did not intervene until African Americans started to fight back, in which case they began to arrest African Americans. So super, super highly fragmented ribbon in 1960. If you go to Jacksonville today, it's a place that did something pretty interesting. First, it's one of these metropolitan areas that annexed all of its suburbs. As a result, it's like one of the biggest cities and county footprints, but there's not a lot of city, county, or you know how in Massachusetts you're a great small box government place, so like all these little governments, right, that will not collaborate with one another? You can't do that in Jacksonville because it's all just one government. It closes the social distance. Second thing in Jacksonville is something that's remarkable that's called the Jacksonville Community Council. It brings together people from all different walks of life, multiple sectors, who go through a leadership program and each year are supposed to adopt a problem and try to address it together. Homelessness, poverty, job training, multiple sectors creating a conversation together around those problems. We were intrigued because it turns out Jacksonville, by the standards of the South, right, has actually done better in recent years on race relations. It's growing more equitably than most of the South. It does what a lot of metros try to do, attract business, but it will only give a subsidy to a business that's paying 135% of the median wage. So every business that comes in has to be, for them, high road, right, or lift up. So was all this conversation part of that strategy? Now, if you're an economist that's traditionally trained, it's pretty hard to imagine that talk would make a difference. It's also pretty hard to imagine actually going visiting places and talking to people about that. We should just model it and test it on the data. But we decided to visit. And what we did over the course of a couple of books was to develop a notion of epistemic communities, knowledge communities, where people create mechanisms to share knowledge. A lot of this has been developed in the literature, but the way it's been developed is around professional epistemic communities, professional practice, and experts solving problems, particularly around international relations. What we wanted to do was to deploy this down to a sort of community and civic level, and to complicate it, to look at diverse and dynamic epistemic communities. Were they diverse in terms of bringing together people from different sectors, different ethnic groups, different class? And were they able to respond to shocks and change? And by doing that, create strategies for leadership development, create interactions. The big insight here, jumping over a bunch of stuff, actually comes from this great book by Yohai Bengler, The Penguin and the Leviathan, which I really urge everybody to read. It's actually wonderful. What he says is that Economists have tended to model the world as though it's Hobbesian, nasty, brutish, and short. People are self-interested, and they compete. And in that Hobbesian world, either you have to have the state to coordinate and suppress everybody, or you have the free market and you believe that that's going to lead to a parade of equilibrium. He says that doesn't explain Linux. It doesn't explain people coming together and coding together, right, to develop and cooperate. So what are the mechanisms under which people cooperate, and are there, and when you have structures that encourage atomistic and self-interested behavior, of course, that's what you'll get. If you've got structures that encourage solidarity, you make it solidarity. And so our question was, do these regions have different structures? If this sounds familiar, Sam, it is. We quoted heavily from Sam, from Identity Economics by Akerlof, and from Benkler, who wrote a more sophisticated book than this, but I barely understood it. I understood this one. So what we did was we looked at a lot of different places, some places you wouldn't really imagine. Salt Lake City. I know you might say to yourself, how could Salt Lake City be a place you would take a look at? It's a lot more diverse than you think. It's actually a lot more equitable than you think in terms of its outcomes. And it's a place that's got something called the Utah Compact, which was an agreement amongst civic leaders, business leaders, faith leaders, and immigrant rights people to have a more civil conversation about immigration. Utah had driver's licenses for undocumented 6 years before California, in-state tuition for undocumented 1 year before, 1 year after California. They've got a planning mechanism in Salt Lake called Envision Utah, which brings together people from multiple sectors to talk about how the Salt Lake Metro ought to look. A lot of, they've just put in a rail line. They're very proud that it runs from the airport to downtown, but they're particularly proud that it runs to the lowest income Hispanic area in Salt Lake, and it's providing employment to the downtown and to the airport. There's something about the way folks came together. It's not all kumbaya. One of the stories we tell in the book is about San Antonio. If you went to San Antonio now, one thing that they boast about, everybody talks about collaboration, collaboration, collaboration. They were able to bring one of the promise zones from the federal government and a promise neighborhood and a sustainable communities initiative. They were able in the city of San Antonio to pass a sales tax to finance K-12 education for disadvantaged kids. It's pretty amazing when voters do that. What was perhaps most amazing was that the San Antonio Chamber of Commerce supported it. If you'd been to San Antonio 40 years ago, this is where the Industrial Areas Foundation cut its teeth on their sort of new form of organizing. In San Antonio, the west side of San Antonio, largely Latino, was disenfranchised through an at-large election system, so they couldn't get African-American or Latino candidates onto the council. They were literally disenfranchised in terms of public investment to prevent flooding. They became very vibrant community organizers who challenged the Chamber of Commerce. They got a hold of a secret plan that the Chamber was using to market San Antonio as a low-wage metro. They embarrassed them, they challenged them, they froze the most important bank in town. The owner of that bank actually wound up buying the book Rules for Radicals by Saul Alinsky and passing it out to all the business people saying, this is what we're up against, right? That same banker is now the chair of something called Project Quest, which is a joint community city workforce development program to put people into the middle of the labor market, which is run by this community-based organization. The fights actually led to collaboration. third case, and then I'll close on a couple of reflections of what this means for the election. Is Seattle. Seattle, as you know, went to the $15 an hour minimum wage. It did it before Los Angeles, something we're very upset about. And it did it through a very unusual thing. It did it through something called the Seattle process, which is quite literally a cultural process in Seattle of talking things through. So they've got a pretty dynamic affordable housing program, came as a result of the Seattle process. When they raised the minimum wage, it was a fight, but they also created a commission that had 25 people on it. At the end of the commission, 23 of the 25 supported the increase to a $15 an hour minimum wage. The only two holdouts were the Trotskyite member of the Seattle City Council. She wanted the minimum wage to go up to next year. And the head of the Chamber of Commerce, who said that she was in favor of the increase, but she couldn't pull all of her members to get them to agree on it. They literally figured out a collaborative process to get there. There's a lot of problems in Seattle, but there's a lot of a knowledge community being created to try to talk things through. So that's what this book was about, and it was sort of optimistic that a lot of what we were learning at a metro level, which was that where people came together face to face, race to race, and place to place to talk things through, that there could be solutions moving forward, was an optimistic vision, and it's one that's been rocked, of course, by this election. Just a couple things about the election, and then close. It certainly was an election deeply reflective of social distance, of people feeling that the other can be completely dismissed. Nancy Pelosi, who I actually don't normally quote, said a great thing about Donald Trump, which is that he has mistaken cruelty for strength. And cruelty is only something that is possible with tremendous othering and distance. This is a weak regime, and because it is, it could actually be more dangerous moving forward, because I think it's going to wind up sort of relying on the sort of deportation sideshow when it doesn't get the economy working again, because the fundamental thing holding the economy back at a U.S. macro level now too is this level of inequality and lack of opportunity. Just like that's a secret at the metro level, it's an open secret at the national level. That means that as we move forward, we need to speak about the economic anxiety and economic distress, but not lose the fact that race is an important part of that. It's going to require a compelling economic vision. I'll just say a couple of other things. I think it's going to require much more paying attention to geography. That's a little bit evident for the following reason. Hillary won, but she lost because of geography, right? 3 million more votes in the wrong places. Interesting stuff going on at a metro level. How do we bubble it up to the nation? And then a profound need, I think, on our parts to recognize something. And I do think it gets back a little bit to this book and then a little bit where I want to close with, what did I learn from Sam? So this is a huge movement moment. And those of us who have been thinking about organizing, working with organizers, raising sharp critiques of the society, etc., see the stark contradictions that are being lifted up and about to be lifted up, and we might be excited about how this is a political moment. I think one of us, our biggest mistakes would be to think of it as a purely political moment. That is, if you think about the phenomena that's emerging, and in particular the Women's March, where people didn't march there for a political reason per se. They marched there out of a sense of solidarity with other people, out of a sense of the need to be kinder with one another. It was a movement that got lifted up initially by white women, and there was some distance because of that. There's a wonderful piece by Lisa Garza, one of the co-founders of Black Lives Matter, talking about, nonetheless, how do you put aside your own trying to interpret it purely through a political lens and go with the strength that's built there. And the strength that's being built there is profoundly about humanity, about solidarity, and about values. That's what we saw in these metro regions. That's in part what our econometrics was demonstrating to us. That's in part what this political moment is. And that's kind of what I've learned from Sam. I know what I should have learned was theory. I know what I should have learned was statistics. I'm okay at that. I know what I should have learned was to ask persistent questions, because Sam, particularly when he's your advisor, has this irritating habit of just asking question after question after question and having you do, I think I'm done, oh no, I'm not. But what I really learned from Sam was the difference between, theoretically, thinking about economic man and thinking about human beings and how they actually behave. And I remember being with Sam, he came to visit me at Occidental College and had a delightful argument with one of my colleagues who was talking about why having a fixed retirement age was good, because that way people could plan. And Sam went back and forth with him about the microeconomics and said, you know, but it just really made me sad when my dad had to retire. He didn't really want to. And I feel like it's just kind of not human to force that on people. And I thought, my God, that's really what should be driving us. What I also learned from Sam, and this has been of great comfort in the decisions I've made professionally, is that it's not about being the smartest person in the room or having the best possible job. The only real bit of advice Sam gave me when I went out on the job market, aside from good luck, was that the trick is to find a good job in a place where you want to live, which again is profoundly human. And the third thing I learned from Sam and continue to practice is that, Michael mentioned it, some of the wisest ideas are with the community people that I work with. You know, people in their bones understand that when you treat people badly, the team doesn't work. People in their bones and in their organizing realize that when you build one-on-one relationships, you have solidarity in each other's struggles moving forward. People even in business know that when you have sustained relationships between buyers and sellers, it's not about short-term advantage, it's about sustaining that market going forward. I learned the value of being a public intellectual, and I learned that, yeah, it's a good idea to tell a good story. Thank you.
And one of the things that I really care about a lot is rural. We keep having conversations about urban. And you talk about otherizing, and yet there's no, where's the space for rural to have a conversation with urban and metro, because it continues to fall out? Where's the space for this? Because rural actually does what you're talking about. And in terms of the election, people are blaming white rural men who are losing their jobs in manufacturing industries and coming back to those places. And I know they are not rural, but I'd like to understand if there's if there was any space for rural in what you do, and where's those points of intersection?
That's a great question. Let me complicate one thing you said, and then get at it. Which I think, and I take this really from my colleague John Powell, that it's too simple to say it was white rural men. There's a couple of other things that were playing on there as well. Number one, just election-wise, if we had been able to run the kind of campaign that had motivated, you know, 100,000 more African Americans in Detroit, Madison, and Milwaukee, I'm sorry, and Philadelphia, that's the election too, right? But
well,
the other thing,
white women voted for Trump as well.
Yeah, they did. But I think that the other part of this is that it's really the sense of loss of identity, right? So I think that this I borrow from my colleague John Powell, who's a race theorist at UC Berkeley. So it's people, when the economy was shifting and the demography was shifting at the same time, feel like, what's my place in this America? Mm-hmm. And that's what I think is being lost. And that there's a reaction that's coming out from that. Yeah, I mean, it's true. I mostly do metro work. I got kind of fascinated in this because we were trying to do a lot of this work in Los Angeles, and I was trying to see how it worked elsewhere. The fact that I'm on this metro kick actually happened after the LA civil unrest, when a bunch of us were sort of running from meeting to meeting, thinking if we went to one more meeting, we'd actually solve something. And in the middle of one of those meetings, someone said, you know, while we're thinking about recovering this part of the urban economy, other people are talking about the regional economy. How do we start thinking regionally? So I've been on this urban and metro trek. But you're right, I think that the rural side of things has been ignored by a lot of folks, and it's absolutely critical. It's also really uneven. You might have seen the article in the New York Times just yesterday about some rural areas are actually really thriving, and some of them are actually thriving in part because they have new immigrants coming in as well, transforming the area. So, more questions? Yes.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed your talk. And I was particularly intrigued by the example of Jacksonville, Florida.
And let me know who you are.
I'm Fidan Petulis, and I'm an associate professor in the economics department, and
great.
I do labor economics.
Okay.
And I'm particularly interested in civil rights issues. So you framed the example of Jacksonville, Florida, starting off with the 1967 riots, civil rights sort of riots. And then you told us about how Jacksonville now is the largest metropolitan area. It used to be tiny and now it's huge. And then you talked about how there is a lot of community discourse of inclusion. But I was wondering, was there a connection there in terms of did the presence of those riots trigger something? What was the kind of the discussion leading up to making this very large metropolitan area? Was it because of the civil rights discord that triggered people to create a large metropolitan area in the hopes of creating a more inclusive community? Was that kind of was there a causation there? Or I was just wondering whether we can see that kind of relationship more broadly, where towns that had civil rights protests later on, we see this sort of geography, a designation of geography that's large and leads to more inclusion and
Gosh, what a great question. And the answer is yes. I don't want to claim, in the book we're very careful to say that these things are associated with, they seem to be going on at the same time, but they're getting these economic results because we're really making an assertion of plausibility, not a, there's not an economic metrics on epistemic distance, right? But for Jacksonville, the axe handle Saturday was an immensely embarrassing incident. It happened in 1960. There was some attention to race relations. The annexation piece, which was sort of now you can't become a suburb, was something going on in the South at the time for a different set of reasons. There's a much tighter connection in two other places, and then a sort of interesting sort of reverse story in two other places that are in the book. In the book, we wound up wanting to look at three places in North Carolina and three places in California, because we wanted to hold state contexts constant. And then look at, because you could say, well, all this has to do with state rules, et cetera. So in North Carolina, we looked at Raleigh and Charlotte and Greensboro. And in Charlotte, Charlotte and Raleigh are both places that tried to position themselves as emblematic of the New South. And by what that meant was not the explosive racial blobs. So Charlotte merged with Mecklenburg County and created a rule where no suburb could become a suburb. As soon as you got big enough as an urban area, you were absorbed into the city. So you couldn't become a suburb. They created a single school district and created a busing system. And the first people on the busing system were the sons and daughters of the white banker elite, because they were trying to market, I mean, self-interested too, they were trying to market Charlotte as a place that didn't blow up. Charlotte's the first place that elected a black mayor in the South in a non-majority black city, Harvey Gantt. And Charlotte, no surprise, is the place that passed the LGBT rights, transgender bathroom use rights, right? That became the big fight in North Carolina in recent years. Raleigh actually has a very similar history. You might know about the Raleigh School District. It's also a place where voluntary busing, and they did it by, or not voluntary, they did busing, but they did it by class, not race. And they got, they've done very well. Folks love it. Tea Party candidates got into the school board and killed it in the last couple of years. But it's like one of the enormous success stories of the South, right? Et cetera. You can contrast that to Greensboro, very famous for its own civil rights struggles, also famous for the shooting of civil rights workers in the 1980s. If you go to Greensboro and talk to people, because we actually went and talked to people, so that's an interesting thing to do. Whites will say, why do black people keep talking about the past? And African Americans will say, the past is vibrant, it's still here, this is still a racist structure. People are very much at odds with one another. Not surprisingly, the place hasn't been able to sustain economic growth, and it's not a Raleigh or a Charlotte in terms of generating economic growth. Charlotte has a program that tries within the city of Charlotte to target its lowest income neighborhoods every year. So, that's, and move them around. In California, we profiled Fresno. Fresno looks like San Antonio did 40 years ago. Huge racial conflict. The description from progressives about Fresno is that it's DOA, development, oil, and agriculture. They all rely on cheap wages, low wages, so they make sure that any good economic idea is DOA, dead on arrival, and it's incredibly fragmented politically. It's now starting to make some progress coming out of that. So I think these things really do, you really, in answer to your question, you really do see some relationships. Is it one for one? Is it absolute? No. But is there a plausible sociological story that goes along with this economic story? Yes. Thank you.
It seems possible if you look in other times and other places, you could find very unequal societies that are growing. If that's the case, and even if it's not the case, isn't equality valuable in and of itself? Wouldn't that be a much stronger argument?
Well, I would agree with you that equality is an important value. It's one that I hold too. I would also agree that in some cases, most of the work I've done has been looking at the United States since the 80s. So it's pretty clear that there's an income inequality sort of U curve where, complete equality might smash incentives and slow growth, complete inequality has the same negative impact on incentives, smashes growth. That we're sort of on the wrong side of that trade-off, right? So it's true these are sort of time contingent estimations of this. Getting back to the first thing, that while I agree with you that equality in and of itself is a value, that's one that I hold, I'm not sure it really moves the needle that much in the United States, that linking the level of inequality to the jobs crisis actually has more political traction. Talking about why inequality, particularly at these levels, is toxic for our politics, toxic for our society, and toxic for our economy is, I think, an important argument to make. And so that's the sort of narrative or political shift that I'm trying to make. Perhaps one more question, then we'll close. Yeah.
Yes, excellent presentation. I promise I'll read the book before I even see the movie. two things about I want you to touch on is the global context. I guess you did mention immigration and so on, but I want you to get your view about the growth differentials between the U.S. and the rest of the world, where one issue is that U.S. is not growing. There are some parts of the world which are growing, which are actually growing faster than the U.S. may be changing the global balance. So, and that may, whether this may also fuel this fear of the other, in the sense that this China's going to get us, they're going to invade us economically. And that's why also feeding the fear of losing jobs to other economies and so on. The second one goes back to the excellent question, was about rural versus urban. When I think about a number of autocratic regimes, modern autocratic regimes, they tend to focus on winning and keeping control over the rural population, and sometimes even forget about urban areas. Think about Africa, Ethiopia, and so on. The only thing that's holding ANC in power in South Africa, because they don't care about the elite. As long as the larger population, uneducated, rural, supports the regime in power, they're fine. But how sustainable is that calculus in the US? If Trump or his regime is not 2-3 years from now is not able to give the goodies to deliver the goods to the rural community, how is he going to keep the idea that he's the savior of the rural area if he's not being able to bring the jobs that he intends to do? Because he can keep ignoring the Los Angeles and New York.
Yeah.
I'm wondering what kind of things are we going to deliver to the rural community to be able to hold the community.
Well, I think that's going to be a challenge for a number of different reasons. So, first, there's an interesting thing that came out from Brookings after the election, which is that the counties that voted for Clinton have about 2/3 of the nation's GDP. First, the counties about 1/3. So, in terms of economic vibrancy, that's a really sort of key thing. Second, I think this is where the rural communities are going to really experience a shortfall. aside from like just how screwy the economic strategy would be generally, if you think about the tax cuts, the benefit of that to rural communities is going to be pretty minimal. Here's the thing that's the most striking to me, the thing that's going to be sold the most as being good for communities is the infrastructure package. But the infrastructure package is based on market, like public-private partnerships, and basically follow the market. Nobody wants to build like a new highway in a rural area, right? That's actually a recipe for bringing more investment to urban areas. So I fear there's going to be a lot of disappointment. And when there is disappointment economically, then, and that sense of identity is being denied, then this other sense of identity that's made more powerful by deporting people, by unleashing a police against African Americans in urban areas, which is the newest Jeff Sessions announcement today, which is they're going to go back and look over every one of the consent decrees with the police over the last couple of years. That stuff is going to be really symbolically important as the economy is not doing well in those areas. For me, looking at the metros, aside from the fact that I just thought that they were interesting, it's also, and I think we should be honest about these things. Part of the reason I study things is because I need my political salience. I'm pretty convinced that if you, like, the only way you're going to win Texas is by moving Houston and Dallas and Austin and El Paso. That's the way you win Texas, is by moving those metro areas and their suburbs. You'll note that the campaign for $15 an hour moved in metros before it moved to the state level. You'll note that community benefits agreements came out of metropolitan organizing. You'll note that a lot of metro areas have climate plans, even when their states do not. So I'm really convinced that the metros are a very useful political vehicle and are a useful epistemic vehicle because they're where people have to have conversations with one another. As for the international side of things, my God, that's a big question. I think that's a question that should be answered by an incoming chair.
Okay, let me thank our speaker.